Well, actually, I think we would just have a conversation. Say what? Well, you sit there and I'll sit over here. You may have talk loud. Well, I'm going to move right into a... Well, why don't you stand up and let me see that outfit? You want to model it for me? Walk closer a little bit and... This is tech fashion, is it? That's close enough. You're going out of the camera range here. You look like you got a corn cob stuck in a strange place. Come here, let me see those glasses. I don't see you often in glasses. Okay, that's good. Right. You're moving in and out of frame, kid. Give me one of your soccer fakes, huh? You have to back. Oh, we want to see the TKE pin. Well, that's pretty close, I guess. Yeah, that's neat. That's neat. Put it in the sunlight. There you go. There it is. Wow. So how do you like being a teak? It's what? That's your graduation pose, isn't it? Yeah.
No, it's super pledge pose.
It's your super pledge pose, huh? So what this is, we've got the date on here, September 2nd, 1990, the year of our father, right? So tell me about these pants, these short pants you've been dying to buy and you just bought.
Yeah, got them on sale at Bridges.
At Bridges, huh? And what'd you pay for those?
$19.
$19. That's not bad for a pair of Bermuda shorts, huh?
Damn good.
Yeah?
Well,
you're going to have to back up a little bit because you're filling up the camera.
All right.
There you go. We'll get your full frame here from your skinhead to your white socks, right? Well, you look like a young adult. I mean, you don't look like a teenager anymore. Yeah.
Well, I gotta buy my brewski.
What's the brewski?
Beer.
Oh. Brewski. Oh, that brewski, huh? The brew, huh?
Buy a brew.
This is just a pint of bitters, huh? What was that one you were doing earlier today, the Monty Python and the old lady's voice?
Everything's up, Sam. Well, we've got eggs, spam, and toast. Well, I like the egg, spam, spam, and rolls, love, spam.
That's good. He's perfect. I think we'll get you a job on Monty Python.
Yeah. John Clay Sees the Best.
He's the one that plays the woman?
No, John Clay plays Sir Lancelot, and he plays the guy who wants to buy the print license, and the guy who... Oh, look, there's still a complaint. Well, I bought this. Noise and blame, not more than half an hour ago from this very store. You assured me that this term lack of movement is due to its being tired and worn out from a long squawk. This parrot is dead. Now it's resting. How's it going, Dave? So, man. How was the party last night, man?
Oh, it went quite well.
Very good.
Huh?
This is tech fashion. Oh, I've got to get these white socks. Oh my God! Like a couple of guys from Land's End. I swear to God. No, I'm his older brother. Oh my dad. Do I look that old?
What? You mean nobody else dresses like this?
Nobody and nobody but people in Atlanta would dress like that.
Really? You ever see Atlanta? No, but the thing is, I figure anyone dresses like this.
You just trying to fit in?
No, baby, these shoes are great. I mean,
they look good.
And they're like really, really comfortable. I mean, the girls like them too.
You mean the girls wear them?
No, they have them, yeah. But, you know, they have them for girls. Some, I've seen some. Not really, not really. I think you need one pair, maybe. I don't know. But,
your new shorts or your old legs?
These are very sexy.
Sexy legs.
Why do you think he's important now that he's a tee?
Actually, he's only important because he's my son. Well, you know, just for the record here, you're Wesley Walker and you're a freshman at Georgia Tech, right? We're on the campus of Georgia Tech in Atlanta.
This is West Campus.
This is West Campus? Is that what you said?
Yeah.
Okay.
This is Caldwell.
Caldwell what?
Resident Hall.
Oh, I see.
Caldwell Resident.
It looks prettier on the outside than it does on the inside, huh?
I don't know about that. Actually, it's pretty ugly all the way through.
But at least it has nice oak trees.
Well, yeah.
Yeah. How comes all these people are going to study and you're not? You're going to ace all your exams, are you?
Yeah.
Well, you have two exams?
Chemistry and pre-calculus.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Were there any messages you want to send to anybody back home? You want to send a thank you to your grandfather for helping you come here?
Oh. Grandpa, thank you. I wrote him on it.
Huh?
I wrote him on
it. Did you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Is this
greetings. This is Farmer West from Tech and Passerby. Greetings from everyone here at Tech. I hope everyone is doing well in Fort Myers, Florida, and we're doing here well at Tech.
Where did you get this act?
This is Bill and Ted.
Bill and Ted. Who are they? I don't know them.
Mime and Ted.
Huh?
I'm a mime. But
this is mime, not yours. You're a big ham in normal life. We put you on the camera and you freeze up, huh? Anybody you want to say a special hi to?
Lane. All right, this is to Lane, too. Carry on. Be excellent to yourself.
I'm going to turn this thing off.
Okay.
You're getting silly. Who are you, Richard Nixon? Or Bill the Cat?
Yeah, Bill the Cat. I'm Bill.
Is Bill the Cat better than Garfield?
Of course, Dad. Wow, relative speaking. Well, y'all be good to yourselves.
You want me to shut this off or what? Is there anything you want to tell me about tech for posterity? Anything you want to say to your future grandchildren? Because this tape's going to be around a long time.
Oh, no, God, no.
Anything you want to say to your sons or your daughters? Whomever they may be.
I'm going to make them turn. Tech, I don't know.
Well, it just doesn't have to be about school. Well, I think it'll be real humorous for you to be able to show them what kind of person you were at their age when they were starting off to college.
These are going to be cool.
So are they still going to be in style in 40 years when you've got kids here?
Hell yeah.
Actually,
I am the trendsetter.
Actually, it'll be a little sooner than 40 years.
Think so?
Although, I don't know. In 40 years, you'll be 58. You better have kids.
Yeah, yeah.
Your kids will be out of school by the time you're 58.
Hopefully, man. Anyway. I don't have anything to say. Get out of here.
See, now I can tell with the phone, I can see this little red flashing light on the camera.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, for my part of this presentation, I would just like to announce that I'm Richard Walker. I'm Wesley's father, and Wesley's here on the Georgia Tech campus matriculating. What are you doing, looking for him? Are you looking for Wesley, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I feel real good. I didn't see all the tennis shoes up in the tree. Why don't you show them? Come over here. Get up and walk with camera and come take a look at all the tennis shoes in the tree. And back up and give them a wide angle shot so they can see all the shoes. Not you back up.
Oh, you still got it on, huh? Well, as I was saying before we were so rudely interrupted by the shoes in the tree, that I drove up to Albany from Fort Myers on Friday, watched Jonathan, my other boy, who's now 16, play football. And John did quite well playing football, and I drove up here today. Would you stop that? Are you tired of this game?
No, I'm playing.
I know you're playing. It's like you're taking pictures of my buttocks. Me bums, as they say.
Oh, me bums.
And there you have it. Actually,
just need proof.
If you look over there, if you want to know why they have a yellow jacket as a mascot at this fine institution, it's because they have smashed bananas on every bench. They're particularly unusual bananas. I think they're from Trinidad or some special place. They're grown especially for the university here. Wesley's smiling big as a Cheshire cat. I can see Wesley's a great comedian. He's a terrible cinematographer. Put him behind the camera and he goes bonkers. Put him in front of the camera, he goes stiff. Well, since Wesley was the fashion setter for tech, I want to point out a few of my new garments. Acid washed jeans. Bassweegian tenny pumps.
Tenny pumps.
These are South Georgia white socks, worn by nerds and rednecks alike. Would you turn the camera vertical? It gives people a headache. And this is a fine pullover shirt from South Fort Myers in a coral color. Totally accented by a new black cross pen, which I bought for myself. All right, that's the end of my story.
You are looking at the shoe tree from Caldwell Residence Hall, Georgia Tech, Atlanta, Georgia. This is what makes Caldwell the dorm of West Campus. It's got to be the shoes.
Well, today is officially Labor Day, and here we are with our typical teenage laborer, Mr. Enoch Mugwump. Now, Mr. Mugwump, what is it that you labor at most often? Is it getting out of bed or eating biscuits? Or is that making honey?
Well, I know. I labor so many things.
Well, I understand. I hear tell that the trouble with doing nothing is that you never know when you're through. Do you have that problem?
No, that's why I'm a laborer.
Well, I'm going to zoom in on your kneecap here. Now, tell us about those bruises on your chin and on your arm. This is the second day after your first football game of the 1990 season, is it?
Yeah, we were playing Buckheads and Carol. Okay, Dad, I won't cut. Sorry, great-great-grandchildren. I was an horny little cuss, wasn't I? Well, we were playing the Stupid Hicks and Carol, and well, they don't know how to play football. And
so they beat you up?
Well, they tried, you know. They tried to spear me in the chest and the throat and the chin and bust out my teeth and poke my eyes out, but the Stupid Hicks just couldn't do anything.
Is that why your voice is so much better now? Yeah. You did get speared in the throat, didn't you?
Yeah.
Didn't it hurt?
No, I just chop myself in the throat all the time.
This is what Wesley did to me. He turned the camera sideways like this. You get the slant? No, you got to turn the other way, John. Yeah. Well, how'd you get those bruises on your arm? Is that your country mother? Did she whip up on you for not taking out the trash? I know you're scared of her.
She's got this big stick with nails in it.
Does she threaten your life with it, huh?
No, just my limb.
Well, I saw her give you a hug when she got back home.
Yeah. That's just a zero, huh?
Oh, I see. You know how Winnie the Pooh got his name? What you spitting on? Is there some scientific significance to this?
Yeah.
See if there's spittle ants or what? And what's your hypothesis? They can't swim?
Ants don't like spit.
Are you as rude and crude as they say?
Well, one can only try.
What was your last favorite book? You do read, don't you? Name some of the books you've read recently.
I got partway through Sinclair Lewis.
Partway through?
Yeah. First 3 pages of that bad courage, that really sucked. No, don't, none of you grandkids read that book. Not even good, it's boring. Red Cask of Montiato.
That was Poe?
Yeah.
Did you like that one? What do you have for English?
Doc Hawk.
Doc Hawk, huh? You're not chewing tobacco, are you?
No, I'm not speaking pig.
But you're not a preppy either, are you?
No, not right now.
Do you intend to be one?
No, I'm straight back to you. Tight ass preppy.
Well, what's the favorite thing for teenagers to do in Albany, Georgia? In the 1990s.
Well, watch the grass grow.
Yeah? Is that cannabis?
Well, you know, you got several species of grass. You got greenest grow its real slowest, and greenest, kind of brownest grow real slowest. Yeah, that's about the rest.
Does any of your friends smoke the grass after it's grown?
I don't know about that.
Tell me about your best friend, Chuck.
Well, Chuck's kind of lean and lanky and got big ears and a big old nose.
One of your best friends, is he? Sort of like the butterfly effect, huh? Well, what's the name of this farm that you live on? Where is it located?
Somewhere in the state. AKA Lee County, halfway between Albany, Good Life City, and small town life.
Life is pretty slow here, isn't it?
Yeah. Of course, you know why they call Albany Good Life City.
Why is that?
Because we're the top five cities in the world competing for murder capital.
Hadn't that gone back to New York yet?
No, it went back to D.C., but I think we'll get the pilot next year. And then we've been holding the title Divorce Capital of the World for a long time.
I refute that. It may have some other claims to being a contender for the title in Georgia, but... I think the West Coast has us beat hands down for divorces.
I don't know about that.
Well, didn't the Places Rated Almanac put Albany in a very prestigious position in the top five, or the top of the bottom five places to live in the country?
Yeah, it is one of the worst places to live.
And why is that? I mean, economically, it's slow.
Yeah.
But is it slow culturally?
Very.
Well, don't you think you have any opportunities here to grow culturally?
Yeah, if I want to be a country hick.
You don't think Baryshnikov would come here and dance for you?
No, I really don't care for his Russian ballerina.
Why is that?
Well, they stuff their socks down their pants, make them look like they have big balls.
Is there anybody you want to say hi to in the future? Your sons or daughters? your future wife or grandchildren? How about your future daughter-in-laws?
No, I don't know them yet, so no reason to say hello.
Do you miss Wesley being gone?
No.
Why is that? More food on the table?
More food on the table. Better food on the table. No snotty brother around.
Well, I understand you have an antique Chevrolet automobile.
Right. Runs on gas, all things.
That's not the thing of the 90s, is it? Not the best motor fuel?
No. They got this stupid, crazy Arab named Saddam Hussein.
Yeah?
I'll probably read about him in the history book. Oh, he decides he wants to take over Kuwait.
And what's Kuwait?
It's the richest country. Well, actually, it doesn't exist anymore because Iraq annexed it. For all you little kids out there, that means he claimed it as his own.
Oh, I see.
So anyway, the United States on their crest with Saudi Arabia, then in a whole bunch of troops, Saudi Arabia to keep Iraq from invading Saudi Arabia and controlling 45% of the world's oil supply.
Kuwait has that much?
No, but Saudi Arabia controls 25%.
Mm-hmm.
And Kuwait controls like 15%, and Iraq controls like 5%.
I guess that's why God called it the Fertile Crescent, huh?
Yeah, even though it is a wasteland, wouldn't want to live there. Give me air.
Well, do you think you're gonna, the war there is gonna start? I mean, do you think we're gonna have a war there?
I don't know. We might. But I'm just saying it's stupid.
Well, would you go and fight? Would you sign up to fight in the desert? Why not?
War sucks.
What do you know about war?
All I know is people get killed. I don't feel like dying right now.
Who would you send over in your place?
You.
Oh, gee, thanks. I escaped one war already. I don't want to have to do it again.
I accept probably. Women are so superior.
Is that your true feeling about women?
I don't know. We'll see. I'll have to wait till I meet my wife.
Oh, how you gonna know her if how you gonna know her when you see her?
I'm gonna stop a big sign on her neck saying, "Hey, I'm your wife."
Well, what kind of woman do you think you want?
A live one.
A live one. Tall, short, fat, skinny, pretty, ugly, smart, dumb. One like your mother. Why do you keep looking over your shoulder for, John? You think I'm trying to trick you?
Trying to intimidate me. I'll offer no comment on that remark. Due to the fact that it may incriminate me in the future.
Oh, it's pretty wise. Well, you understand that this this little exercise in video cameraology is to get you trained for when you become a manager and you're interviewed on camera, you'll know how to conduct yourself. Is this interview over?
I don't know.
On the
In the 1990s.
Well, wait a minute. You didn't tell me that you had that baby on. When did you turn it on?
I just turned it on right now. How do I get it to go off?
You push the red button again.
Richard Walker. Fashion statement.
Fashion statement, huh? And what do that... It looks to me like... Oh, you want to see my macho Basswegian tinny pumps with my redneck socks, as I pointed out yesterday on the Georgia Tech campus, my acid-washed Levi jeans, and my Florida color pullover, cotton, all cotton shirt, and my titanium glasses that got the crap beat out of them in the last basketball game that I had Thursday night.
Uh-huh. So you play basketball.
I have been known to indulge in, actually what they need is someone to block up the middle. And since I'm not a jumper, I stand in the middle and keep the little rascals from driving through towards the basket. I probably account for two or three people. you want to get a lean on the subject too, huh?
Just experimenting.
Cinema verite, huh?
Yeah.
This has been a rough weekend. Are you pointing that thing at me, or what?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see, I drove up here Friday night to watch Jonathan play football. And was pleasantly surprised that John was still walking and actually starting left tackle on the offensive team. And unfortunately for John, his gigantic opposition was no match for him. John did come through with a few bruises and unfortunate circumstances about his body, but he his opponent was carried off in a wheelchair. Screaming, no, no, don't hit me again.
So you can see this man knows how to flatter his son. He knows what's good for him.
He knows what's good for him. Well, how much of that $50 did you actually earn? I feel guilty for giving you a cracked windshield.
Uh-huh.
Well, let's see, we stayed up until about 12:30 on Friday night, and got up Saturday and went shopping, and then John and I went had dinner down at AJ's Oyster Bar. I had the usual catfish and a couple of mugs of beer, and Jonathan had the unfortunate experience of meeting an oversalty grouper. Let's see. Oh, then Bob Alexander took his guests and me on a moonlight cruise up the, what's the name of that creek, John? It's not the Chickasawhatchee.
Kitchafoonee.
The Kitchafoonee Creek. Yeah, and I got to hold the searchlight.
Wow.
So we could find our way back. Quite frankly, I think we were illegally marked. And Bob wanted to drift back down the river, so he shut off the engine, and the engine wouldn't restart. Had the ladies on the cruise in somewhat of a panic, and I guess they that was their panic was exacerbated by the quantity of alcohol that they had consumed at dinner time. Sunday, I got up and drove 3 hours to Atlanta to see Wesley. Wesley and I had lunch at the Varsity, which is a fast food restaurant
filled with nostalgia for old Georgia Tech fans and graduates. The food was horrible. About the only thing they had good was a peach pie, and that was fried too.
So basically, it's your normal greasy spoon, huh?
Most definitely. Without the spoon. Well, Wesley and I hopped a MARTA, went down to Five Points to see the Atlanta Underground, which was rather interesting. We were both trying to figure out why so many stores were below ground. And the only thing that we could figure out was that there was quite a large hill, and they needed to smooth the hill out a little bit, so they elevated the road up one story. When I came back from Atlanta through Columbus and stopped off to see an old friend of mine, and got back here about 10 o'clock. This morning I got up about 9, and I'm packed up and ready to go back to Fort Myers. That's been my Labor Day weekend, taking care of my children and my other responsibilities.
Say, how'd you get all that black shit on your face?
What are you talking about?
All that fuzzy stuff.
Oh, are you talking about these hairs?
Yeah.
How did I get it? Well, you'll just have to grow up and find out.
Hear that now, young chillins? That's a fuzziest beardus attached to his face. A symbiote, and provides him with a fair amount of warmth, and he provides it with nourishments and occasional haircuts.
Actually, I cut my own beard. You're supposed to cut your hair vertically like this, because people can't see the lines. They can see horizontal lines a lot easier.
An interesting piece of nostalgia from the Richard Walker Zone.
Okay. Well, folks, it's about time for me to take my stool and head on out.
Ooh, sweat stains, sweat stains. There it goes, folks. The man, the legend, Richard Allen Walker.
Remember, keep your stool loose.
Comedian. Father. Weirdo. Walking off into the sunset. Oops. My bad. He's walking south. So he can't be walking into the sunset. Well, this is Jonathan signing off for Father and Son Talk. Oh no, look who's coming back.
You see how happy I am?
Don't hurt yourself, Dad.
Hey, I'm in good shape.
Yeah, good shape to get killed.
There's a lot of people who just rather sit here. And some people would just rather. covers.
Yeah, I like the one that they're in.
I'm healthy.
You gotta fight the bugs, yeah.
Well, here we are in Albany, Georgia, and this is my dad, Lindsay Burnis Walker. And you're going to be in November 9th, you're going to be how old?
November 6th, so it'll be 77.
77, the big 77, huh?
Yeah.
Now, you think you're going to...
Lucky numbers.
You're going to feel any older?
Oh, no, of course. Of course not. I got to make it to 87 because I want to be here when the year 2000 comes out.
Oh, is that?
I'm curious to see what sort of condition the world is going to be in the year 2000. See whether we're really learning anything by our experience.
Yeah.
Or whether we just repeat it all.
Well, you were born in 1913?
Yeah. November.
You were born in... there's a lot of gnats around today, aren't there?
Oh, yes. I believe... that there's been enough advancement, technological, sociological, and about every other logical, since then, that we've been very lucky to have lived during this period. There's been more progress during this time in all aspects of our culture than there was in 100 or maybe even 1,000 years preceding that.
And how do you measure progress?
Well, it's a subjective thing, but I think that everyone thinks of having the better life, which equates to having it easier, healthier, greater longevity, more pleasant things to deal with.
You mean like age?
Well, age should be a pleasant thing, except for those unfortunates who don't have it very, very good.
Well, I'm wondering, just to play the devil's advocate, I'm wondering if we really do have it better, with things are going so fast in terms of technological change, does it create more stress? Do we actually live happier lives?
I think we do. I happen to believe that life in general gets better all the time. It doesn't get better in leaps and bounds, but in aggregate, over a period of time, it gets much better. Life is much better in just about every aspect than it was when I was born, or even when I was a boy.
You know, what were things like when you were a kid?
Well, there are lots of things to talk about. What do you want to know about?
No, just your general everyday life. How was your everyday life when you were a 10-year-old different than your everyday life now?
We lived in the country a long way from town, and it was a small town when we got there. We didn't receive a newspaper. There was no radio or television or anything of that kind. It took weeks, if not months, to learn what was going on in foreign countries.
Or downtown. Excuse me, one second. Do you want to sit down?
So I think, in general, we live longer lives and healthier lives than we did back then. Not too many years ago, 40 years of age was an average age for an adult to pass from this world. And we think nothing today of people being in their 80s when they finally come to their end.
What kind of chores did you have to do when you were a kid?
I had to chop the kindling wood and bring it in and have it beside the stove, and fill the coal scuttle and bring it in. I had to clean the ashes out of the stove from the day prior.
Did you use both wood and
we
coal,
used,
or did
we
you use
kindling
to light
kindling
it?
Wood with kerosene to start the fire. And from the time I was about 7 years old on up, it was my job to get up before Dad got up and to build a fire so that the room or the part of the house that was heated would be warm when he and Mother got up. You know, farmers always, practically always, I guess you do now, but they always got up early then, and they did their feeding and milking the cows and so forth before sunup so that they could be out in the field doing whatever they had to do by sunup.
How did they see in the barn? I mean, did they have
lanterns or something in the barn to milk by? Or?
Well, where I grew up, the animals were always fed outside. Mm-hmm. And usually about the only protection they had from the cold north winds was about an 8-foot board fence.
You didn't have any milk cows?
Yeah, we had milk cows. Most times when I was young, we had one or two, and we got more as I got older, and we had more children. And my senior year in high school, I had to milk 7 cows before I went to school. I'd get up at 4 o'clock in the morning and go up and sweep floors, since Dad was a janitor of the school, and get back home about 7, and had to milk 7 cows, and I'd go in and get washed up and dressed and have my breakfast and get to school by 9.
And you got to school on a pony? Did you say?
No, at that time we lived only a quarter to a half mile from school. Earlier, when I was back in grade school, I had a Shetland pony that was given to me on my 6th birthday. And I rode it to school 2 miles and back.
And what was the pony's name?
Cricket.
Cricket, wow.
And that pony lived until after I'd been working in the Library of Congress.
Oh, really?
26 or 27 years old. And she was owned by one of my brothers then.
It's sort of about 77 years old in horse years, huh?
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
Well, what was your primary, you were talking about changes. I think foods and packaging of foods have changed. What was your typical breakfast, lunch, and dinner like when you were a child?
Well, for breakfast, we usually had oatmeal or sometimes we had cornmeal mush we ate with cream and sugar. We usually had meat that had been grown and cured on the farm, always lots of eggs. And Mother made biscuits every day of her life, I think. That's the sort of thing we had.
I was curious, when you talk about milk and all those cows, did you have electricity on the farm so you could have refrigeration?
No.
Did you have an ice man come around or
what? No, we lived, I'm not sure whether there's an ice plant in the nearest town. We lived probably 50 or 60 miles from the nearest place where you could get ice.
Well, how did you keep the milk from boiling?
We built a cooler. And a cooler was built right outside one of the windows, so you could open the window. And it was kind of a box. It had a sheet metal bottom in it, and water was in it, maybe 3 to 4 inches deep. And you put a cloth over your milk, set it in there, and usually in cans or buckets, and put a cloth over it that hanged down in the water, and the water would come up, you know, by osmosis, mm-hmm. and come up over the milk. And the breeze blowing through there created the cool that would keep it down around below 70, actually all the time. It didn't spoil quickly.
Yeah. About how long could you keep that milk? Could you keep it a couple of days?
A couple of days, that's about all. And we'd skim the cream off of it and keep some to turn into clabber, which I like to drink, and the rest we fed to the hogs.
Oh, really? You didn't make butter and cheese?
Mother made butter, but no cheese. And whenever we were milking enough cows that the products were not used by my family, we'd take them into the creamery and sell them, along with the eggs we had. Mm-hmm. We sold a lot of eggs.
Well, you were doing some cotton farming work?
Yeah, Dad raised cotton, and he raised enough green sorghums to feed his livestock. And we raised corn, both to feed livestock and make cornmeal, and have some to sell. But cotton was a big cash crop.
How many acres do you think you had?
Well, we had 160 acres, and I think over 100 of it was in cotton, and some green sorghums and corn, and then we usually had a small pasture for livestock to run in.
Did you learn to grow vegetables as a child, or did you learn that a little more scientifically as an adult?
I learned that as an adult after I was working in the Library of Congress, 1939 and later.
On the farm, did you have a vegetable garden?
Yeah, Dad usually raised some things. He mostly wanted to plant things in the field instead of just having a patch that we call a vegetable patch. And many times he would interplant with cotton.
Hmm. Interesting. Well, you You had how many brothers and sisters?
I had 13. I'm the oldest of 14 there. There are six girls and eight boys. Four of the boys have now passed away. Five.
Four of them. So who's passed away now?
The brother next to me, Alvin. And then Jim. And then my two twin brothers, Olin and Nolan.
And your youngest brother is Donnie?
Donnie, and he's 50 years old now.
He's 50, so there's 17 years difference. Great. 14.
I would say 27, 26 to 27 years difference.
Oh, okay, yeah. My math.
I was a junior. I think I was, or maybe I was at LSU when he was born. He may be 51 or 52 also.
Uh-huh.
I think I was a junior at Texas Tech when he was born.
So you were a boxer and played high school football and.
Well, that's after I was after I was older.
Well, when you were a teenager.
I was a teenager when I was doing the boxing until I went to Texas Tech. I was a little older then, but I was on the team at Texas Tech at 168 pounds. Not to exceed that. I played football 2 years. First year I played guard, right guard. The second year I played center on offense and tackle on defense.
This is your junior and senior year?
No, this is my freshman and sophomore year. My junior year I had a spell of pneumonia right at the time when school was starting and when we were beginning practice, and it debilitated me considerably, and I didn't get to go out for football until the season was very late, and the coach said at that time it would take too much to bring me up to the others, and it might as well come out. I did play basketball, and I ran the mile in track.
Well, I never knew that.
Yes, I did. Yeah.
And when did you practice the trumpet? I mean, you said you played the cornet for a while.
Yeah, I played the trumpet I played it 4 years. My last year of grade school, and then 3 years in high school. And when we moved from Amherst, Texas, to Littlefield, Texas, I didn't join the band. I felt that I was too far behind to join the band.
They had a pretty good band.
Yeah, they had a real good band. They had a good teacher, and he wasn't. If he had encouraged me, I would have played there. But he didn't encourage me at all. He didn't even have me for a tryout. I think that might have been because he had all the trumpet players he needed.
You enjoyed the trumpet a lot.
Oh, yeah, I enjoyed it. I wish I had kept it up and gotten a little extra training and then tried to get in the band at Texas Tech. But I had too many activities there to get into the band anyway.
Well, you were a pretty good student in high school?
Oh, yeah, I made good grades in high school. Better than I made in college. I think I had about a B-plus average all the way through high school.
And you boxed and played football and played the trumpet.
I boxed
and milked cows.
In summer, they had in our little one-horse town, Amherst, which had around 1,300 residents total. Farmers came to town on Saturday afternoon, and businessmen built a ring which sat on a vacant lot right on Main Street. There's only one block of Main Street, and they moved it out into the middle of the street, and people gathered around and watched boxing. And I was one of the boxers and made out very well.
How old were you when you started boxing?
Oh, about 16.
And you boxed for how many years?
Well, I boxed until I went to high school when I went to Texas Tech. And I started Texas Tech in July, and in November I was 20.
What year was that?
1937. No, 1933. I'm sorry. I graduated in 37.
Well, I thought your experience with the finding work while you were in college was sort of interesting. You started off in cleaning stables.
It amounted to that. I had to work because my family had no money to send me to school, and I had accumulated enough from the jobs I had in high school to buy my books and to pay my first month's room rent in the basement of a man's house where we just had a hot plate. And I did my own cooking there, and I would hitchhike home to Littlefield, which is 36 miles away, And Mother and I would cook up what we could for me to put in fruit jars and take back with me to eat during the week.
That was great.
She did our laundry, my laundry. And before the summer was over, I got a job cleaning the dairy barns after the cattle had been, the cows had been milked every morning. And then a little bit, well, later in the day when I could, had time for my classes, I worked on the farm, hoeing cotton and so forth on the college farm. But then when summer came, I got a job maintaining the National Guard stables. They had horses at that time. And my particular job was taking care of the major's horse. The major was the commanding officer.
We gotta move. You wanna turn your chair a little more towards it? Actually, it's an interview work. Yeah, you can turn it more effectively, I guess, if you want. The how's that?
Pretty good.
Okay. Well, we were talking about my employment in college. I lived in a room. It had a floor in it, but little else. It was sheet metal all the way around. I lived in that all one summer. And boy, did it get hot there, because, you know, out in the Panhandle, it's not unusual for temperature to go up to 110 degrees.
Wow. And no breeze?
No breeze, and that room wasn't located, so it would catch any breeze anyway.
And where? What town is Texas Tech in?
Lubbock.
Lubbock.
There's a town of about 30,000 when I left there, and now it's 150, 160, maybe 180,000. Spread all over. Well, I went home after the summer was over, and when I came back in September, I got a job working in the college printing office, sweeping the floor and melting down type metal and casting the cuts that they use for pictures in the paper and that sort of thing. But very soon I learned to run the flatbed presses. And
like Ben Franklin?
Well, it was more like putting it here with that hand and taking it out with this one. Well, I got an NYA job, which gave me $19.80 a month.
What is NYA?
National Youth Administration. And it wasn't long before the school, the journalism department, hired me for as many hours as I felt I could work. And although they had some kind of limit on it, I don't remember what it was. But they gave me 40 cents an hour, and I was really in the money then. And it was not unusual for me to work 100 hours a month. Which, along with my studies, kept me pretty busy. I did my studying early in the morning. I did that in high school, too, because, well, I could absorb more,
mm-hmm.
and that's about the only time I could find. In high school, I was into a lot of activities. Even in my senior year when we moved to Littlefield, I was in a whole bunch of plays. And at Amherst, of course, I was always in athletics, and I was on the tennis team as well.
Hmm.
I played on, with the guys on the tennis team in Littlefield, but since I was transferred from Amherst to Littlefield, they thought I might be ineligible just my senior year, so they wouldn't let me be a member of the team. That kept me from playing football there also.
Hmm.
I went out and worked out with a football team, but I was bigger and stronger then. I heard a couple of guys and said, well, you're doing me no good out here. You might as well quit and go in.
Well, you were how heavy were you in to your senior year?
About 180.
180. Mm-hmm. And you were 6 foot tall?
Yeah.
You must have had some pretty good upper body strength from boxing and all.
Yeah, I think I did.
And you played nose guard and tackle?
Yeah.
It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was. I enjoyed it.
It was a good way to spend time with your friends.
Well, at that time, the center that played on defense up in the line, he didn't serve as a linebacker. We didn't have a two-squad team. We didn't have that many guys.
Yeah.
So we had tackle, end, guard, center, and the same on the other side.
Yeah. And they just flipped over to defense?
Yeah.
Played both sides. Well, I guess football's changed quite a bit since you played.
It surely has.
Well, what kind of equipment did you have? Did you have a?
I had a leather helmet.
No face guard.
No face guard. They didn't have face guards then. And Mother and I practically remade my uniform, giving me a little more protection there. And my pants were short enough that they came up over my knees, and I skinned the living daylights out of my knees before she sewed some canvas on to lengthen about 4 inches.
Do you have knee pads?
Yeah, we had knee pads, but they were usually up here. And I've still got scars around where I got stepped on one time, and it cut a gash in the back of my leg, right in the bend of my leg, and it took forever for that to heal up.
Did you have thigh pads?
Yeah, yeah.
So essentially,
and kidney pads.
Kidney pads. Up here?
Yeah.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Well, you said you got a job running the flat press for 40 cents an hour.
Yeah.
And then, how'd you get to be business manager of the newspaper?
That was an office that was filled by election by the student body. And I got in the political arena and ran for the job and was elected. I had one opponent, and I beat him hands down.
Well, how did you know you could do this sort of thing? I mean, did you have a financial background?
No, it was just that do what you're talking about, the business management or the politics of getting elected.
Well, either one. I mean, they sort of says, well, I can do this sort of thing. How did you know you could do that sort of thing?
Well, I knew what it took. Having worked in the college printing office for a couple of years, I knew what it took to be business manager. And I was taking journalism courses.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a course in advertising, and I just knew that I could do it. And so I propagandized the student body into believing that I could do it.
All seven of them? Yeah.
Well, at the time I was elected, there were around right close to 5,000. And I think I got a two-thirds majority in there.
So you printed your own handbills, did you?
No, I sold advertising to the merchants in town, but I seized upon a couple of gimmicks that worked like a charm. One was that I put out a special edition every time anything unusual happened around school. Like, we always had an April Fool's edition. Mm-hmm. We had a homecoming edition. And, we had three or four special editions during the year. And I sold a lot of double-page ads to merchants downtown. Then, I don't know where I got the idea that it would be good to, effective to have some of the city dads, like the president of the First National Bank and the chairman of the Chamber of Commerce and the mm-hmm. president of the Business Bureau and so forth, to go around and help me sell advertising, which they all agreed to readily. But in order to convince them to do that, I heard of a survey that had been run at the University of Wisconsin on the contribution of the school, economic contribution to the community. So I wrote to them and got the stuff that they could give me, including a questionnaire that they circulated, and I revised it to fit Lubbock, Texas, and printed it up on the printing press there in the printing office, and took it to the girls in two fraternities and got them to distribute it to the advertising.
You had girls in fraternities back then? I mean, these are sweethearts of fraternity members, or are these sororities?
Well, they were sororities. Yeah. And then they helped me tabulate the results, and I worked them up and got them printed and sent them out to the businessmen, who were very impressed by the contribution of the school to the community, economic contribution. So I had no trouble in lining up guys, one guy, a different guy each time, to help me with each edition of the newspaper. And they went around, and actually they sold the advertising, and many times I recall that they didn't have to do any selling. They just walked in and said, I want you to take a certain size ad for this week.
Well, what was the flap about the compensation that you were getting from this? This was more than anybody else had gotten, and the school didn't want to pay you?
Well, I made out pretty well. As you recall, things were pretty tight back in the 30s, and by the middle of the spring semester, I had made more money in my commissions than most of the professors were getting. And the business manager called me in and told me what he had discovered, which was correct, and informed me that they were going to cut my commissions because I was getting more money than a student should have.
What percentage were you getting?
I was getting 5% on local advertising, no, on national advertising. All you had to do was write a letter to get tobacco advertising and that sort of thing. I was getting 10% on all local advertising. So it added up. During that year, I think I made around 36. That is actually more than a lot of the professors were making. So I asked the business manager if he would like to tell like me to tell him what I was doing with it. He said, yes, of course. So I told him I didn't have any clothing when I got here, and I now have a sensible amount of clothing. I owed for the first 2 or 3 years I was in college, and I have now paid all my debts. But my parents incurred some indebtedness for a couple $1,000s for pavement that they put in front of our house, and they were paving the whole street, and it was just an assessment, and my family was in danger of losing their home unless that was paid, so I paid it off for them out of money that I had saved during that year. And the old business manager was very complimentary. He said, well, I think you've been very sensible in the use of that money, and I have no criticism of it. And if you continue to operate that way, I see no point in breaking that contract that you entered in good faith.
And so how long were you business manager? Just 1 year?
Just 1 year. 1 9-month period.
So you were able to, during that 9-month period, pay for almost your entire college education, undergraduate?
Well, it didn't work that way. I had, all the time I was working, I was paying my room and board and paying as much of my fees as I could, and I usually didn't have to borrow more than $50 to $100 a semester. So, as I recall, I owed about $300 and something when I got to where I was able to pay for it, but I paid all that off. And I also had enough cash money to get me to LSU and to pay my fees for the summertime when I went to graduate school.
And you went over there for a summer job one time?
I did work in the library. I worked there the first summer I went down there, and then they gave me a job when I came back, and I worked the whole time that I was working on my master's degree.
And your master's degree was in library science?
Library science. Very fortunately, I met the man and the name of George Schredman. He was chief of the Union Catalog Division of the Library of Congress, and his father lived in New Orleans. And I heard he was in town, and I called him, and he came to my office and talked to me. And I asked him about a job for an ambitious young fellow, and he said, well, they're about as good as the ambitious young fellow wants to make them. Well, how about a job? Oh, no, I'm on vacation. I couldn't even talk about it with you, but you send me an application, and we'll see what we can do. And I sent him the application. I had it in the mail by the time he went back to the library, and I didn't hear a thing from Christmas time until near the 1st of March. No, it was later than that. It was almost the end of March. And he offered me a 3-month temporary job at $300 less per year than I was getting where I was working in New Orleans for the Historical Records Survey. I knew that job would end sometime soon. I had to find another one. I wanted to get in the Library of Congress anyway, it being the very best of all libraries in the United States, because of its size and diversified services and so on. And on, I guess it was April the 27th, I got a telegram offering me that job, March 27th. So I got on the bus and went to Washington and sent Mary back to her mother's and father's home.
Well, you had gotten married in the meantime?
I got married at Christmas time of that year.
So this was 1939?
Well, we were married in 38, and I went to the library in 1939.
Uh-huh. Well, what made you think that you were qualified to work in the largest library in the country?
Well, I knew that they took a bunch of people who had just graduated from schools of librarianship with master's degrees, and so I figured it they could do it, I could do it, because I had gone through the routine of getting myself prepared.
Mm-hmm. And your grades were that good to compete? In college and graduate school?
Yeah, they were good.
Did you achieve any I almost said notoriety, but that was the wrong word.
The only thing I achieved in college, any part of the college that could be considered notable, would be that 1,500 freshmen, about that many, at Texas Tech took what they called an intelligence test, and I came out number 3 in the school.
Mm. Does that mean you were bright?
Well, it must mean something like that. At least several people told me they thought.
Well, I remember seeing a picture in the I want to call it the Toreador with the
Toreador was a newspaper. The La Ventana was the yearbook.
Oh, what does La Ventana mean?
The window.
The window. Oh, I see. That's Spanish, the window.
Yeah.
And there was a nice picture of you in a leather jacket with curly black or wavy hair.
Yeah.
And it said that you had been you were in the who's who of college. College. Seniors and that you had a sizable library, a personal library.
Yeah.
You sort of sound like Benjamin Franklin now. I think this is a strange parallel here. The fellow runs a printing press and he's...
Well, I've been working on my pot here and it's almost as big as what he had.
You mean the Franklin stove?
Yeah, but I don't have 13 illegitimate children.
Well, that's only a rumor. They were French children, so you never know. The French people are... notorious lovers, so you can't tell who's they were. Well, how long did you work at the Library of Congress?
I worked there from the first day of April 1936 until the 30th day of June 1973.
And how many years was that? I'm too tired to count.
Well, altogether it was about 36.
36 years.
Of course, I had 3 years out for military, but they gave me credit for seniority purposes in the library while I was in the Navy.
And how did you get in the Navy? What did you do?
I heard from, well, first off, I heard from one of my friends who was in the Army that they were giving out commissions in what they call the Army Specialist Corps for librarians. So I decided to go to their office and talk to them, and I rode the streetcar as far as I could and then walked a mile to get to their office, only to find that they had moved a good long way from there, and I didn't have the time and I didn't have the money to buy streetcar fare to get there, so I started walking back to the library. I didn't have money to ride back to the library, and I was uptown on G Street, and
so you're about 2 miles away from the library, huh? Well, three?
About three. So I was walking back and I passed the Navy Officer Procurement Office. And I saw a guy in there that used to be a clerk to one of the justices of the Supreme Court, whom I had lunch with over in the Supreme Court building every once in a while. And I greeted him, and he greeted me, and he wanted to know what I was doing downtown that time. And I told him what I was doing, and he said, well, why don't you apply for a commission in the Navy? I said, okay, give me the papers. So he put me through permanent preliminary interviews, and they gave me a preliminary physical, and he gave me a whole sheet of papers to fill out and told me to bring them back as soon as I got them completed. And I took them back the next day, and about 6 weeks later, my commission came in the mail, and I got orders to report for this communications school in Connecticut the 1st of December 1942. Which I did, and then after 2 months there, I was assigned to the staff of the Commander-in-Chief of the Atlantic Fleet.
Well, I remember a story about the Admiral of the Fleet coming to the school and asking for bodies, and you had the warmest or something like that?
Well, that's not exactly the way it happened. Commanding officer of the school and the other officers there felt constrained to offer to the staff of the Commander-in-Chief of the Atlantic Fleet the students who had done best in communication school. And I lucked out. Of the 365 students there, I made the best grade of any of them. And so I got orders to report to the school.
And what?
I mean, to the staff.
What kind of training did you receive in that school in 2 months?
Well, a lot of it was about Navy organization and the terminology that was used in the Navy. And then we learned about the technical aspects of communications, about codes and ciphers and, mm-hmm. and security and things of that kind. So I went to the staff and Commander Chief of Atlantic Fleet, and they put me in something called Operations Plotting. It wasn't communications, but we took the communiques that came in, the messages that came in, and plotted the position of our ships and convoys and striking groups on the Atlantic as of 0800 every morning. And then we worked on it during the day, getting ready for the next day. We made a copy of that and gave it to the Admiral, and he used it for writing orders, basing the orders of our striking groups on it and rerouting ships and convoys. I would have already started on the next plot, so I could mm-hmm. get it done.
And you had a small plotting board you took home or took to bed with you, so to speak?
Almost. I never lost so much sleep in my whole life because I plotted until around 11 o'clock, 11:30 every night.
And you got up at?
Well, I had to be up in the office and working at 7 in the morning. And somebody got the bright idea of having us stand a midnight watch aboard ship, so about every third night, I had to stand a deck watch from
4 hours, yeah.
From midnight until 4 or from 4 until 8 the next morning. And then go get shaved as quickly as I could and get my breakfast and get up to my plotting activities. I got a nice commendation for that, though.
But what was the commendation?
The commendation was that I provided the Admiral of the Fleet good, sound information which enabled him to write orders for the hunter-killer groups, submarine hunter-killer groups, which went a long way. Their effectiveness went a long way in winning the Battle of the Atlantic, which had an awful lot to do with our getting supplies to our mm-hmm. groups.
So that you were specialized in the plotting submarine?
I plotted the location and route of travel and so forth of German submarines. And I even got to know the numbers of the submarines and what their capability was and what their how big their crew was and the name of the commanding officer and so forth. And we had communications intercept going on all the time, so I got to read those messages and move all that stuff. It took a lot of piecing together.
So you were really an intelligence section of the operation.
Well, that's the reason they transferred me to communications intelligence later. And up to the day I retired, I was in the Naval Security Group, which is responsible for milking as much intelligence as possible out of communications.
Mm-hmm. And you retired from the Navy as a captain?
Yeah.
That's an 06?
06. Yeah, and I had enough points. You get a point by a day of active duty, a drill, or a day of training duty, and one for each lesson of correspondence course you completed successfully. And then they added all those points up and divided them by an assimilated year of 365 due days. And that gave you a factor, and they took a percentage of your highest pay based on that factor, and in my case it came out 22%. So for a lifetime I will get 22% of the pay of a captain. And I had enough years that I was in the government. They have increases in grade. In the Navy they call them fogies, and they get them to you up to the time you had 30 years service, and I had all the fogies you could get. That worked out nicely.
And so that nets you how much money a year?
Oh, about $14,000.
That's not too shabby, is it?
Well, it's a good supplement to my civil service and social security mm-hmm. annuities.
Well, let's go back a little bit and talk about family. I understand that
they're a bunch of rascals.
Rascals? The little rascals? You mean like Spanky?
Yeah, what do you want to know about it?
Well, I was just, since I was number two, I wanted to know about the circumstances about number one. I mean, you were off at war, and he was born in 41, was he?
The brother next to me?
No, my brother.
Oh.
Robert Kent, you know, the one in California?
Well, I was away to war. He was born before I went on active duty.
Oh, I see.
And he was only a couple months old when... Well, a few more months than that. It was under a year old when I went on active duty. And I didn't get to come home an awful lot, maybe once a month, just for a weekend.
Mm-hmm.
Because Mother was living in our house in Chevrolet, and I was either in New York or New London or Boston or Casco Bay up in Maine during that time. And it was a bit of a chore to get home. I didn't get to stay home very much. I could leave Friday afternoon after work and travel until the wee hours to get home. And no airplanes, always had to ride the train.
Mm-hmm.
And then similarly, when I got ready to go back, I had to be there by 8 o'clock the next morning, so I'd have to leave very early Sunday night. I'd be dog tired the next day.
How long would it take you to get back from Washington to, say, Boston?
Well, from
the all-night ride,
New York to Washington, from Washington to New York is 4 hours. Another 4 hours to Boston, and another 4 hours up to Casco Bay. So that's 12 hours altogether.
Casco Bay is where?
In Maine.
In Maine.
Portland, Maine sits on Casco Bay.
Mm-hmm. Out of the four kids, what was the funniest incident that you can recall happening to you because of them or them?
Well, it wasn't so funny at the moment, at the instant, but I think Bob spilling the bucket of paint all over himself was about the funniest. I wanted him to paint the chicken house with aluminum paint, and he agreed, but he had to get up higher than, he had to get up on something, and he insisted on putting a box on top of a barrel, which was pretty precarious, and then he insisted on overfilling his paint bucket. I told him he was likely to spill it, and he turned me off and didn't listen. But very soon, the box slipped, and he fell, and the bucket of paint went all over him. He was wearing no shirt, and he was painted with aluminum all over, including his hair and his ears. And I laughed at him, and he got furious at me.
How old was he then? 12 or so?
Yeah, somewhere around that age.
Right.
That's about the funniest thing.
Oh, that's really nice. Let's stop there for right now. Give our cameraman a break.
I think it went on and hit him about here. Came up this way and went all down here and ran down his chest. We had to clean him off with turpentine. And that burned some. He was an unhappy youngster. I still kid him about that. Ask him, in the long run, do you think that enabled you to listen a little bit more attentively to your father's advice? Hell no. Education a while ago, I didn't cover the work after LSU. When I came to the Library of Congress, particularly after I became Assistant Director of Personnel, which was after I had been there about not quite 3 years, I decided that the best place for me was in administration rather than in public service or technical services. So I figured to be competitive there, I needed some graduate work in the field of public administration. So I went to American University and signed up for some graduate courses. I learned that I already had what was required for admission to candidacy for a doctor's degree. And I found that was the right choice. Administration was my field in the library, and I think that was the reason that I was successful as assistant director and director of personnel and as executive officer of the Congressional Research Service, who incidentally now is called administrative officer, and who doesn't have quite the scope of responsibility that I had as executive officer. So I worked out 66 hours of work toward my doctorate, which is all I had to have. I think 60 hours is all I had to have. And I selected a thesis topic and started collecting materials, and I had most of it collected, and of course I wrote a précis of it, which my faculty advisors approved, and I had most of the first chapter written when it became necessary for me to go to war.
Which was 1940?
December 1942. When I came back, I found there had been a tremendous lot of development in the field of public administration, and I would have to take another several courses to get up to scratch. And also, with respect to my thesis topic, it was going to be reorganization of the Library of Congress under Archibald MacLeish, poet administrator. MacLeish had become Assistant Secretary of State for Cultural Affairs, and they had another librarian there, Luther Evans, who had further reorganized the library. So it was not a viable topic. And to find a new topic and to go over all that work of gathering materials was a major undertaking. Also, my job as Director of Personnel was very heavy. I was taking work home with me 3 and 4 times a week, and chief assistant librarian said, well, I don't know why you want to continue with this degree, because you've been here long enough that we know you for your capabilities, native and otherwise, and frankly, I doubt that taking courses of dubious relevance to your work here in the Library of Congress is going to help you get ahead. Now, if you decide not to stay at the library and to move around from one place to the other, always looking for opportunities, it's a very good union card, and I would advise you to go ahead with it. Well, I like the Library of Congress, and I didn't intend to move around. And in retrospect, I think I made out just as well by staying there as if I had moved around. So I stopped work on my doctorate, and I wish many times I hadn't. It would be a very nice thing to have. I agree that it probably would not have helped me in the Library of Congress, because I got to the super grade level there anyhow, and I could not have done much better anywhere else.
You retired at what grade level?
The top of grade 15.
What was the other PhD that you secured? I think this was with the Boy Scouts.
Oh, this was just a training course in Boy Scouts called Wood Badge Course. And it's referred to, I guess humorously, that it's a PhD of scouting. I got a lot of honors in scouting. I had been a scout while I was in grade school and high school, and served as an assistant scoutmaster while I was a senior in high school. And then I didn't do anything with it until Bob and you came along and got ready to start doing some things in scouting. And I started out as a Cub committee person. Then I became assistant Cub master. And then both of you moved out of Cubbing, and I went over to the troop of Boy Scouts and was made a member of the training committee. And then very soon I was made chairman of the training committee. And then I became institutional representative, which meant that I represented my institution at the council level. And after a little while, I became chairman of that group. And then after a little bit, I became chairman of the advancement committee for the council level. And then I also had a spell as chairman of the camping committee. And I took a couple of busloads of boys to the Philmont Scout Reservation.
That sounds like an awful lot of work. What was fun in it for you?
Well, seeing the boys develop, and it was just the camaraderie I had with the adults was great, too. One guy epitomized it by saying, you know, this business of scouting would be most attractive if if it weren't for all these damn kids.
Speaking of kids, didn't you run a teen club for the recreation department?
Yeah. Let me finish the scouting by saying that my contributions there were great enough that they gave me two or three awards, the highest of which was a Silver Beaver Award, which is the highest medal that can be awarded. It's a national medal that can be awarded on a council basis. And our council usually got three a year, and I got one of them 1 year. And there was, we had about 75 districts in our council, and my district had some 500 units, cubs, cub packs, troops, posts, and so forth, and around 20,000 boys. I was district commissioner for 3 years, and I had 205 guys helping me as commissioner.
And when did you start that district commissioner? What year was that? In the 60s?
Somewhere back there. I don't remember now what the exact year was.
Looking back over your life, what would you say would be the most trying time?
Educating a new director of the Congressional Research Service. He came in, he was a smart man, but there was an awful lot he didn't know. And he did not want to respect the rules and regulations laid down by the administration of the library, and he was forever wanting to use me to get around them. And I was the most reluctant assistant in that respect. And
now, this was your replacement?
No.
Or you say the
he
director?
Was the director, and I worked for him as executive officer. And he wanted me to trample on the rules and policies of the library, which I knew would just get both of us in trouble. And trying to keep him on the straight and narrow was a real challenge. And he got awful upset at me, accusing me of being afraid to do anything unless it was in the book and things like that. I knew that might hurt my chances to get promoted and all that kind of thing.
Well, wouldn't he be the one to promote you?
Yeah. He would. Or at least to initiate it. I don't think the way it worked out that it actually slowed me down. But there was a time there when I felt I was going through a trying and difficult period.
How long was that? And what was the final outcome of that?
He got educated.
In other words, he bent to your will?
No, it wasn't that. I found ways, lots of different ways, to get him to talk to higher level officials in the library about what he wanted to do. And I'm sure on many occasions he says Walker won't do it. Walker's dragging his feet or something like that. But his attitude generally changed. And upon my retirement, he presided, and he said that I was very effective, an intelligent and innovative employee, and that he could not have done his job without the assistance that I provided. I felt like that atoned for all the difficulties he caused me.
And out of all those 77 years, which were the most gratifying?
Oh, I guess when I was able to retire and knew that I would have a good annuity for the rest of my days. It took me a long time to get accustomed to retirement, though. I would say every bit of 15 minutes.
And what have you done with your retirement years? You retired at the age 59?
Yeah.
What was that? Was it 68 or?
73.
73.
What have I done with it? What a retired person should do, mostly nothing. No, I've had a good busy life since retirement. As you know, Mother and I bought an Airstream trailer, and we've done a lot of travel, seen a lot of the world, the United States, Canada, and Mexico. We've been in every state in the Union at least three times, been crisscrossed across Canada at least three times. We spent 3 months and two trips in Mexico. She and I have been abroad a couple of times. Of course, during that time, I was going on training duty with members of the Congressional Naval Reserve Group, which was about half members of Congress and half staff assistants. And we went pretty much all over the world. So I've got, for a country boy from Texas, cotton farm, I've gotten to see a pretty tremendous amount of this world. There are many other places I'd like to go. I'd like to go back and see some of the places I've already seen.
I remember seeing a picture of you with Peter Graves of film fame. And who is the most impressive figure that you've ever met?
You're talking about any particular category or just broad general?
No, just broad general. You worked in Washington for 30 some years and traveled all over.
Working in the Library of Congress, particularly while I was in personnel office, a person who handled a lot of the photostatic work worked in there under my supervision. And an awful lot of scholars came in to get photostats of various things in our collection. And I suppose one of the most impressive persons I ever met, and some of that is negative, was this guy, the poet who was charged with treason for his running away from the United States and writing anti-United States things living he was living in Italy. Now, I can just think of his name. He's a screwball, a real screwball. But he and I got on real good terms. And he used to, while he was working in the Library of Congress, he would come down to the personnel office to get me to go across the street to have a coke with him. And, of course, for me, a little upstart from that cotton patch I talked about was very impressive. I'm sorry, I'll think of his name after a while.
Mm.
But he wound up in St. Elizabeth's Hospital. He'd sort of fallen off his rocker. Instead of being tried for treason, that's where they sent him.
He was a poet?
A poet. A well-known poet. Yeah.
Was it Cummings or Eliot? I mean, I don't know.
Well, he was contemporary with him, but he's not either Cummings or Eliot.
What was it like to work in such an ornate building with so many high-powered people?
Well, you get accustomed to the building in a little while and you don't pay attention to it. It's just a place to work. You appreciate living in that rich of an atmosphere, though.
Can you describe some of that?
Well, only to say that there's about 130 different kinds of marble there that came from all over the world. There are lots of intricate carvings. There's a tremendous amount of paintings. There's lots of mosaics, all of them done by the most outstanding people on earth at the time the library was built, which is in the late 90s, 1890s. It is very impressive. It still is for people who go in there. We don't build buildings like that anymore. You have to go to Europe to see others, but they're not building them in Europe anymore. Functionality has taken over, and getting the most space and performance characteristics possible for the dollar of expenditure is prime consideration these days.
I understand that I'm going backwards here. I understand that your mother was your major supporter when you were growing up.
Well, mother was born with good native intelligence. She had very little education. She had to drop out of school while she was in the 10th grade to take care of younger brothers and sisters because of the death of her mother. But she felt, and she knew from observation and reading, she was an inveterate reader, as much as a person can be who has as many children as she had. She knew that education was an important thing. She knew that education was a way for me to get out of the poverty circle in which I lived, in which she had lived. She said she always wanted, she told me this many times, me to have a job where I had to wear a white shirt and a tie to work. And I suppose I achieved that, I don't know. they couldn't give me any financial support, but she would work her head to the bone to help me by doing laundry and cooking things for me and all that sort of thing, which I greatly appreciated, to say the least. That's about all I can say about that. Now, Dad quit school in the fourth grade to become a farmer, and he had about a fourth grade mentality. I don't mean that he was mentally deficient in any respect. He just wasn't educated. He didn't know anything about education. He didn't appreciate the value of education because all he knew was farming and day labor, and that's all he ever aspired to. If you could have a steady income from a day laboring job, that was about as good as you could have.
So he was not a reader, huh?
No, he didn't even read the daily newspaper.
What kind of relationship do you think they had, she having such a broad vision?
Well, they had a very
vision.
Good relationship. She was completely subservient to his will, so long as things were running along normal. But on several occasions, he would get himself in a financial mess, and she would have to figure a way to get us out of it.
So she was the strong person in the family?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, going back to the experience with the recreation department, Prince George's County, Maryland, what kind of memories do you have of being a teen club director?
Somewhere in the 50s, mid-50s, and I was a member of the Recreation Council of the county, we decided that it was a good thing to establish teen clubs where we could, based on schools, because they had the physical facilities. And they set about recruiting teen club directors, and I said that I knew that we needed one in the Clinton community, and that I figured that we could use our school, and that I would rather do that than to continue as a member of the Recreation Council. I couldn't be a member of that council and the director of the teen club, too, because they paid me, and they wouldn't let me be both. So I took that, and for the first few years, we met in the multi-purpose room of the old high school, and we had, in the highest year, the last year we were there before we moved to the new high school, we had an average attendance of around 330 kids each Saturday night for the whole school year, which I felt was a great contribution to the community because it kept kids from wandering off and getting into other things that weren't quite so good.
Now, where did you develop this seeming intense interest in kids, in the welfare of kids?
Well, I had to, which helped. And I had worked with scouting. I had worked with 4-H Club. I used to be director of 4-H Club in the county. And I just knew that it would be a great help. And it worked out that way. And I got paid the handsome sum of $10 a Saturday night for my work, which I saved. I got one quarter of Social Security coverage out of that for each year, too. So that I had my 36 quarters of Social Security when I got to be 62.
Well, what were you saving that money for?
I bought tools for
it. What kind of tools?
Woodworking tools mostly, but wrenches and just general assortment of tools that you need on a 10-acre farmette such as we had.
Well, tell me about your wife.
Well, that's hard to know what to tell you.
Well, where did you meet her?
I met her while I was working in the library on my master's degree at LSU, and she was studying home economics. And I worked behind the reserve book desk, and I got to see all the girls who came to the library who got reserve books. And they had a system then of teachers referring them to books other than their textbooks, which were on the reserve bookshelf in the library. So I looked over the whole crew and decided which one I would like to date. I dated a couple of them before I dated Mary, but wasn't that a good technique?
You're fly, man.
So I started dating her, I never had any desire to date anybody else.
Well, what attracted you to her?
Well, she was pretty for one thing, and I knew she was smart. And when I got to know her, I liked her temperament. And as I've told some people, as I said, you know, at the time of her funeral, if I had had 1,000 chances to get married, I never could have found a person whose temperament would fit into mine any better than hers did.
Well, how come y'all bickered so much?
That's a part of getting along.
No.
She had a mind to whip on.
She did the bickering. She used to fuss at me because I wouldn't fight with her.
Well, why wouldn't you fight with her?
Oh, I felt it would be unpleasant.
You figured you might lose?
Well, yeah, I might do that too. But I don't know what to tell you. She was a very good mother. She was exceedingly good, having a degree in home economics, at preparing food, nutrition for the family. And she was equally as good in raising children and being a mother.
I recall something about when you were early in your marriage, you had some bicycles, you did some touring?
Let's see, 39, about 1940, I went to the Western Auto Store and bought a couple of bicycles that were more like ice wagons than they were bicycles.
What does that mean, ice wagons?
They had road tires on them. They weren't the kind you buy nowadays. And we took a trip going through Baltimore and on up through York, Pennsylvania, on up to the Capitol. What's Capitol, Pennsylvania?
Philadelphia.
Oh, no, didn't you?
Harrisburg.
Oh.
And then we turned west and went on out to Clearfield, which is 150 or 200 miles from Washington, D.C. And Mary had relatives up there, and we visited with them for a few days. And we rode our bikes back to Washington.
So that took 2 weeks, or?
Well, the whole thing was about 3 weeks. I don't remember how many days we stayed there. It took us close to a week to get up there. We went prepared to camp out, and we did that some. And then we stayed in some board and breakfast, you know, room and breakfast places. And all in all, it went very well.
Well, it seems to me that that life in the early part of this century was pretty physically oriented.
Oh yes.
How would you compare, you know, young people growing up today and their compared to the young people when you were growing up? Any more?
Well, everything we did required more physical effort. For example, and going and getting the coal and the kindling wood that I talked to you about, I had to do some physical work in doing that. Now, about the most rigorous thing a person has to do is to open a valve or flip a switch or turn on a gas jet or something like that. Or go check on the thermostat and maybe flip a switch on the thermostat.
What was the first book you remember reading?
I didn't get to start school until I was 9 years old, and my mother bought some books for me, and I read every one that she got, and I knew she got all the books. She had talked to the teacher, and she knew all the books that I would use in the first and the second grade, and those are the ones we bought, and I knew those books backwards and forwards by the time I went to school.
So she taught you to read, huh?
Yeah. So first day I went, and they put me in the first grade, and before the day was over, I was moved over to the second grade. By the end of the week, they moved me to the third grade, and I stayed there and was promoted to the fourth grade at the end of the year. Then the fourth grade, I got something like pink eye, sore eyes at the end of the school year, and I missed the last 6 weeks of school, so I had to take the whole fourth grade over. It was duck soup since I had been over most of it. And I was reading books all the while, of some sort. I read a lot of them when I was in high school. Most of them history and philosophies. I read all of Poe and all of Emerson and just about all of Scott, Sir Walter Scott. I read the complete book of Shakespeare and several others.
So you were pretty hungry for knowledge.
Well, I guess you could say that.
Where did that curiosity come from?
Well, when you start on something and it's interesting to you, you naturally want to know more about it. And it's just something that wells up from the inside.
And what are you interested in now in learning about?
Well, I'm sort of having a little trouble because I'm too old and disabled from being interested in girls anymore. So I'm looking for something else exciting.
Such as?
I don't know.
What do you do for hobbies?
Reading and listening to classical music. I have quite a collection of classical music. I can spend hours listening to that. And I like to work in my shop. I like to fiddle with amateur radio. And then I like to talk and to listen. And
which one do you do better, talk or listen?
Well, I don't know. I think I'm pretty well balanced in that respect. At least people have told me that.
Well, let's get this interview down on a more serious level, and I want to ask you a personal question. You don't have to answer this if it bothers you, but I want to know what your shortcomings are.
Well, I'm not dishonest enough to say I don't have any. I don't think I could have had as good job success and success in dealing with people as I have had without being fairly well balanced. When you're well balanced, that may mean that from almost any point of view you're mediocre. I don't know. But I like people. I like to talk to people. I like to work with people. I know that to get much of anywhere in this world, you have to do it largely through the efforts of other people. One person is so limited in his capacities that he can't get around to doing all the things that must be done. So you have to be able to work with people in such a manner as to inspire them and motivate them to do things that will contribute to your objective.
So essentially what you're saying is you don't really feel like you have any shortcomings.
I wouldn't say that. I said I'm not brave enough to say
well,
that.
Well, I mean, are you brave enough to tell us about one of them?
Well,
what did you
should have asked your mother that.
I was just going to ask you, what did your wife complain about most?
I had a lot of grandiose ideas as to things I wanted to do, and I'd go out and acquire the materials saying, I'm going to get to that soon, and I'll have all the materials here ready to go. And then 3 or 4 years later, I hadn't gotten around to it. She didn't like all those materials laying around.
But you wouldn't classify yourself as a person who didn't complete projects, would you?
Well, I completed some. To some degree, she complained about things that she wanted done that I wasn't in a hurry to do. And to some degree, she had a legitimate beef. And why I didn't get around to them is because I always had more projects than I could get around to, and I did to doing, and I did the ones that I would like best first, and left others until later, forever. But if you look at it in broad perspective, when we moved out to Clinton in 1948, we moved to the land that, when I bought it a couple of years earlier, didn't have anything on it but some small pine trees. It had been a tobacco farm years earlier. And I largely built the house that we lived in for 7 years with my own two hands, working sometimes evenings and just about every weekend in my vacation time. We moved in June of 1949. And then I built the barn all by myself with very little help. I built the chicken house. Then Mom and I together did the planning for the house we live in now. And in 7 years, we had enough money to make a down payment on it. we paid a little more than half of the total cost of the house when we moved, when we had it built. We paid $14,000 out of about $20,000. I think with a few additions that I added, my total mortgage was for $7,000-something. It cost me the tremendous sum of $99.75 a month, including taxes and insurance.
And you're still living there?
Still living there.
And you've put, in the last 10 years, you've put in how much more into that house?
Probably, considering inflated prices, I've doubled the amount of money that I put into it. If you put it all in terms of 1956 dollars, which was the year the house was built, it wouldn't be nearly that much. But I finished the basement and built some more rooms and put insulation and fans throughout the house, beefed up what was already there.
What would?
Heat pump, developed the patio in the back with a brick wall around it, done a lot of landscaping, and so on and on and on.
And so what would you say that property is worth now?
Around $300,000.
That's for the 10 acres in the house?
Yeah. Yep. I never thought it would happen, but I like to believe that if the good Lord will let me stay here for a little while longer, I will have about $200,000 cash that I can distribute to you boys, or which can be distributed to you boys. And the land ought to be worth $300,000 with the property that's on it. So you should get a little bit more than about, or a little bit more than $500,000 in my state.
How do you feel about leaving such a large legacy?
I think by the time I'm 87 years old, I have to experience all the pain that comes with age and the limited mobility and the limit in the number of things that I can do, and the disillusionment that I will experience from the hell of a mess the world is likely to be in, so I'll be ready to go.
So what you're saying is that you're anticipating a long lingering death?
No. My boss used to say that he wanted to live to be 100 and then die at the top of the mountain that he had ascended in his mountain climbing activities. Mine has to be a little bit different than that. Before my cancer operation, I used to say I would like to live to be 100 and then be shot by a jealous husband. I don't think I could bring that off anymore. So, I wish I'd recover sufficiently from my diabetes that when I reach 99 years old, I can die before a big bowl of ice cream with a large spoon.
Well, what would you say in the last 25 years was the most painful time that you had to endure?
Talking about emotionally or physically?
Neither one.
Physical pain, I don't think you're supposed to remember. You experience it while you have it and get over it and forget it. I don't think I've had any real emotional pain in the last 25 years. Except what I mentioned to you earlier about educating my boss at the Library of Congress, and I can't remember how far back that goes.
Mm-hmm.
It could have been more than 25 years ago.
It seems to me that that you have anticipated and adjusted to